this and understand how the mind is working, how thoughts are associated with emotions, how it's based upon patterns of belief, and how it's held within our subconscious mind, we can learn to wake up into a fuller consciousness with an understanding. And then the process really becomes quite easy. And then the mystery of enlightenment is dissolved. We see that it's the ego, the separate self-ego, that believes enlightenment is difficult. It believes enlightenment exists some other time, or it believes that enlightenment exists only for some other person. And this is all part of the belief process within the mind. Because we have to remember that when someone achieves enlightenment, they're not creating a new self. In fact, they're not even attached to the word enlightenment. And many spiritual masters don't even call themselves enlightened because it's just another label. And the only people who are seeking enlightenment are those people who are still living in the ego, desiring to better themselves. When the enlightened person realized that he had to drop the ego, give up all desires from the ego. So it really doesn't serve the student for the teacher to be calling himself a master. It doesn't serve the student for the teacher to place himself above the student, because a true master understands that everyone's equal and they just return to being normal, and they dialogue with their students based upon what would best serve them and not based upon what would improve the reputation or the self-image of the teacher. So in my understanding, you know, like you mentioned Sri Ramana Maharshi earlier, he was an amazing man because he lived in full realization and he lived the most simple, basic life. He cooked food for the people in his ashram and they built the ashram around him. He wanted really nothing to do with setting it up or maintaining it. He just lived and it started to get formed around him quite naturally. And the whole time he was serving the people. He made himself available 24 hours a day. He woke up early to cook breakfast for everyone else. He wore simple clothes, a lot of times more simple clothes than the people who came to visit him. He ate the same food as the people who visited him. So he was a perfect example of a normal human being and what the state of realization does for someone, how it truly breaks away all barriers, all definitions of oneself, and really brings everyone into the simple unity of what naturally is. So do you have any comment on that, Tamid? I know I was talking for a while.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for talking, but yeah, I mean, it's such a shame that it takes such a bright shooting star like Sri Ramana Maharshi in our world to just give us one quick glimpse at normalcy. You know, mm-hmm. And I think that's again like the main problem here is that you go out, you know, from your meditation into the world and there's still this tremendous, you know, heaving, undulating mass of chaos. And, you know, if you're not careful, it can hardwire you right back into those old associations. And like you mentioned, it truly is all about associations from birth. We you know, paint this picture of ourselves in our minds, and it starts to become us. We start to think that we are it, but it's just a painting that we've made for ourselves. So, you know, you should ask yourself in the very beginning, who was it who went forth from that, you know, utmost emptiness and set out to paint these pictures of selfhood? Who was it who in the very, very beginning set out and multiplied themselves so many utter trillions and billions, just so many times, on a cellular level, on a biological level, on an angelic level, on a cosmic level. All of these are replications of an image in the mind of the self. But that those images weren't framed in limitation.
It's truly interesting when we start to watch ourselves and become aware of all the identities that we've formed, all the ideas of who we should be, of what the world wants us to be, of what is the highest thing to be. We see that all of these are simply beliefs. And the reality of what is when we stop our mind, we can perceive what the reality of this moment is. See, most of us walk in our normal life and we're constantly hearing the chatter of our mind. And for some, we hear it louder than others. Some people are very consumed by the thinking voice within their mind. And it comments upon everything. We walk down the street and it judges the person we walk past. It comments on the car that drives past us. It thinks about what happened 5 minutes ago. It thinks about what's going to happen tomorrow. So we simply spend our time listening to this voice, and we become seduced by it, we become hypnotized by it, and we become confused that we are this voice, that we are the subject of this voice. We are the person that this voice is talking about. And it's quite interesting because it's only just sound and association of past experience. And we have paired emotions with it based upon the experience that the words are associated with. And we believe that that's who we are. And the simple practice of meditation is learning to become more aware of what is outside of this voice. Now, there are many meditation techniques that talk about listening to the voice and follow the voice and watch the voice. But in my experience, that gets a person nowhere. The most it'll do for somebody is give them a little more peace while they're listening to their self-talk. That's about it. What we really need to do is we need to look deeper than the voice. We need to look outside of the voice. And we need to start, you know, asking the question, who am I? And it's like you said, Tamid, we need to find out what we were before the voice, what we are after the voice, what we are between the voice. We need to learn what we are beyond any and all associations of a sense of self, beyond any and all definitions of who we think we are, and we need to see that which always exists as us. Because outside of this talk, this self-talk, there's something else. When the self-talk stops, there's something else. And this something else has always existed. And that's really what's giving the creative power to the self-talk. That's what's giving the creative power to all of our experience. So the goal of meditation is really just to become more aware, and it's not becoming more aware of the sounds in your mind by paying attention to your thoughts. It's becoming more aware of everything, and it's becoming more aware of what we're not aware of. It's opening ourselves up to see more about ourselves, to learn more about ourselves based upon our own firsthand experience. One of the big problems, in my opinion, with modern spiritual teachings is that they spend so much time and energy forming a new identity, forming a new sense of self. So we all want to be special. And this spiritual teaching will show you how to be more special than you were before. My big problem with the teachings of the secret and manifestation is it's a lot of it is about the way it's been applied is about ego gratification. You can be more wealthy. You can have more possessions. You can have more women. You can have more men. You know, there's all of this about all this energy going into creating a new self-image that is better than the person you were yesterday. And unfortunately, it's been linked under the category of spirituality. But it's really not the quest for the spiritual self. It's really not the quest to understand who we are as spirit. We can understand the principles of manifestation, but the goal of spiritual science is really to understand how it works and not to use it for selfish motives. It's not to use it to formulate a new identity that makes you more separate than who you were before or more separate than the people around you. But we're learning, you know, humanity's in a state right now where a lot of people are waking up. I mean, we can look at the movie The Secret or the book The Secret, and we can see so many people getting attracted to these teachings, and that just, you know, emphasizes more what we're talking about today with the new energies upon the earth, because there is a great change as more people are waking up to the fact that we are manifestors. And as this heightened energy comes into the planet, we're going to see how we're creating our lives, not only based upon our own personal projects of manifestation, because I know that's really popular right now in humanity. We're all trying to manifest new homes. We're all trying to manifest new cars and more money and better jobs.